Welcome back. Team Liquid and the Plain Ducks are all tied up here as we gear up for game number three, and it has been an explosive series, so we're glad that you're joining.
Explosive is a very good word to describe what we've been seeing happening so far. The thing is that every time we saw those drafts, what they were trying to do was blow up targets really quickly. Mm. We had that in the first game when they were trying to set it up with a portal on the side of Medivh, enabling Greymane and also the Liming to jump on a target and take it down. That happened every single time. And then on the second map, the copy of the Zeratul and double Zeratul together with the Judgment by Tyrael into the backline and trying to just annihilate Lucio right at the get-go. So the thought process between both drafts, even though they were very different, was kind of the same. And I really want to see if for the third game now, they're actually changing their style a little bit, if they are trying to play a different style in on the next map, or if the idea is going to be the same. Blow a target up, turn it into a quick 4v5, and dominate from there.
It feels like Plain Ducks will probably stay with this type of strategy just because that's what they've shown in the past. But I agree with you. I would love to see some alterations, some different macro play from them. When we saw them play macro, though, against Dignitas, it didn't look so well. They never really got the engages they would have loved to have, and they just slowly got taken out in a 0-3. Let's go ahead and figure out the battleground that we're going to for game number three. It's going to be Infernal Shrines being picked up by Team Liquid. So first pick will be going to the Plain Ducks.
It's also an interesting approach that we saw in the last map, especially to the, let's call it the Lucio problem.
Yeah.
Because right now Lucio is very dominant in the support role, and a lot of teams pick him up early. It goes so far as to him being banned oftentimes. And since he doesn't have a really good escape or any kind of like burst heal for himself usually, like having that lockdown is an interesting point. Because if you remember the draft, they picked immediately Zeratul and Abatha after seeing the Lucio. So that was one of the things where they not only were hoping to get kills in the early game, that didn't really happen because Team Liquid made smart choices by splitting off Varian for the Soak, but they immediately said, okay, we have Lucio against us, no matter what else they do, we are going to try and go in to counter him here. So that was a very cool idea they had there. I really liked the way that they were thinking this out. And it kind of shows what we've been saying, like we didn't really see at first what the goal was,
yeah,
but it was a good strategy behind it when they went into the draft. So it's dangerous to have someone that makes these different approaches happen.
Yeah, and it makes sense too when you think about the weaknesses of Lucio besides just that. He also just can't heal through that upfront damage that was coming from the Zeratul Abbot there. So those type of strategies do work out. Lucio being banned out, Tassadar as well, so no more Lucio on the field here. And something else to know about Lucio before we just completely forget about him because he's been banned out, that shield barrier being so great. If you don't get that upfront damage and he finally does bring out the sound barrier, you're going to have Arthas and all his crew coming at you, and that happened multiple times in those fights. Dehaka, first pickup here. Nande, going to show him off.
Yeah, we're going to talk about the globals here once again, and we are on Infernal Shrines, which from all the maps that we have seen so far, the most normal, the most standard map that we have seen yet. And let's see how Team Liquid reacts to this. Forsett, of course, is one of the options they have if they want to meet the global, if they want to meet the global threat right away. Arthas, a very good pickup for the start. And then you also have Malfurion. So there's a couple of heroes where they really have to say, okay, how do we prioritize this right now? And since it's being Team Liquid, they, of course, have other strong heroes that they like to play here. But oftentimes, in the early picks, we're talking about Malfurion with the bans that we have here. We're talking about Arthas and we're talking about the global.
Yeah, Arthas, Falstad, Ragnaros to a degree too is one of the battlegrounds where he does get slightly taller in terms of pick water because of his defensive capabilities. So Team Liquid now hovering their opinions here. I don't think they're going to go for the Falstad. I feel like they'll get more hard engaged. It just feels like Team Liquid's in a state right now where they just want to go for these aggressive plays. They feel like they can outplay playing Ducks in team fights.
Yeah, the Malfurion-Arthas combo, as just highlighted, is very strong and is probably the one that works out for them the best at this point. Dehaka here is going to give them a bit of trouble. Question, of course, is how are the Ducks playing it? We've been talking a lot about the Falstad potential on someone like Sport Billy, but then at the same time, there's still other heroes that he can play now where he has a huge impact. But the thing is also with Malfurion, sniping the support is getting a little bit harder. I think that really played a role in the decision process here for Team Liquid as well, given what we've seen on the first two maps, because once that he has access to Ice Block, you can just buy some time for yourself and for your team to set up around you and really protect you.
The Ice Block being so helpful in the Twilight Dream as well, with Plain Ducks doing these aggressive plays in the backline, that puts them in a spot where two to three of them will always be in range of Twilight Dream. So Malfurion just works out so well in that regard. So now the Plain Ducks need to start worrying about either Shrine Control or getting into teamfight damage. Right now they look like they're highlighting Shrine Control here with the Gul'dan. Are we going to get an earlier Aurel pickup from them? They move into the Anub'arak.
Yeah, so the Anub'arak first. There's a good chance that they might be Nah, with Inubra probably not. I was like thinking of maybe them thinking of getting the Liming again that they had with Chris earlier, but they already have a Gul'dan in the setup. Oftentimes when you see an Anubarak picked early, one of the thought processes behind it is if we want to get the Li Ming later, we pick her just later after the Anubarak and then our opponent cannot counterpick. But I don't think that's necessarily going to be the case with Gul'dan already being part of it. This is also one of the maps where we could again theoretically see something like Medivh has been played here in the past. But let's see what we're going to have for the bans. Falset as a global also still out. Can be a good disengage if you need it. Let's see how Team Liquid highlights this for now.
Do you think Team Liquid would just ban out the Medivh here? I feel like that would be the only thing that I just wouldn't want to deal with. They get rid of the Aurel for that Gul'dan synergy with Aurel.
I mean, the Aurel provides a stun as well with the 10 main strikes around the shrine, so yeah.
True.
But you could have banned the Medivh here as well if you're really worried about how Spot Billy handles them.
Now playing Ducks, thinking about what they want to get rid of. There is always a Gray Mane that floats around. He's always been a strong hero on this battleground. Also, in the past, we have seen Sonya from Darkmawk.
Yep.
Wouldn't mind seeing the Sonya get a strong front line. Arthas, Sonya, Malfurion, very hard to actually get into a fight and deal with. Gray Mane does get banned out, the hero that we were thinking about possibly getting picked up, but still wouldn't mind seeing the Sonya.
Yeah, Sonya would be a good choice. Then you have for damage, Vala is still around. She was neglected in the last draft, but once again, we have AoE damage that really shines here. We can think about either bringing in a mage. Anubarak still is on the other side, so you have to be careful with that. But for the sustained damage, Vala wouldn't really be a bad choice. We have a couple other of options with this now, too. Sonya, as you said, is really nice to have like shrine control.
I like Sonya more, too, because if Dahaka does not hit that dragon on her while she's in the middle of the whirlwind, she just moves through entire yeah. team comp. And right now, in terms of actual control, there is the Anubarak for the Impale, but the whirlwind is such a low cooldown that you actually don't mind if you get hit with it, especially when you have the Wrath put around.
Yeah,
Medivh
there we go.
And Tychus.
I like it. So they take the Medivh here. One of the reasons why they didn't ban him out, they banned the Aurel, and we've been talking about them potentially getting rid of Medivh. They do it since they pick him for themselves. And given what we've seen from their opponent, I think this is a pretty good choice. I think he could have played around it probably a bit better than on the other maps now that they kind of know what the name of the game is. But overall, Hazops. The one thing that you can really criticize with Hazops from the last game is that he never completed Master's Touch, but besides that, he had some fantastic moments
yeah.
in that game.
A lot of plays. The Leyland
yeah.
Seal, the ability to jump over the wall and bait over the chest material.
The save against Lucio.
The save on Lucio. Just too many of those playmaking abilities. I would say that Medivh for Hazops is more of a passive playmaker type of style, where sports ability is more aggressive in your face, and he will do the moments that are important for your opponent to make a play and deny those. But it's interesting to see how two different Medivh styles do float around for these teams. Now, over the playing Ducks, I'm wanting a little bit more damage, and we're also going to need a support here. But I'm trying to figure out, what does Sport Billy actually play? Do we move into the Falstaff, which I feel is kind of awkward with Arthas control and Tychus control around the shrines?
And you have also, Falstaff is there, double global soul therefore for them, and Rhaegar being picked up.
Cool.
So that's a lot of AoE that they have, and the double global, that leans more towards the macro game than anything else, so that's one of the things that they have to watch out for now. And for Team Liquid, on the other hand, I mean, we're talking about the Tychus, they have the Medivh, another frontliner would be strong. We can talk about the Sonya again, having a Medivh behind you if you're trying to go deep with the Sonya definitely helps quite a bit. So that is probably one of the considerations.
Sonya, Rag.
I mean, I would love a Kerrigan, I just don't think we're going to get her.
An Alarak would be incredible. I would freak out if we saw Alarak here. But yeah, I think a melee frontline is what we're looking for. Something for Darkmawk to pick up.
And there are a few options. I mean, with Arthas, you can copy quite a bit. So they go for the Rag instead. We mentioned that early on a bit. I actually did not expect the Ragnaros from him. I thought he would be a bit more comfortable going into one of the more aggressive, straightforward heroes like the Sonya, like maybe like even Kerrigan and Alarak. We don't see them as often, but it's like a hero that he's extremely comfortable playing with. And it's also one of those mobility heroes where you can just like jump in deep and you're really trying to get those kills. On the other hand, Ragnaros, of course, offers a huge amount of utility on the map with Molten Core during those shrines, and he also has like a bit more AoE. So Ragnaros is definitely a very good pick for them. It's just like, I think from a preference point, I would probably have seen a bit more on Sonya.
I would have gone for the Sonya a little bit more too. I think the only thing that scares you slightly is the possibility of your entire team by Mighty Gusset away, because Sonya puts herself in a position yeah. where she's going to get Mighty Gusset or horrified into the team. Ragnaros plays a little bit more passively overall, but provides decent wave clear enough to handle the Dahaka, and of course you have the Molten Core aspect. So I think they just wanted to go with the safer approach. Sonya would have been impressive to see, but I think they just didn't want to get caught out, because right now playing Ducks, when it comes to team fights, they are very solid with isolation.
Yeah, you can also try to again get those kills with the Sephora Smash and later on if you get a good Howling Blast in first, or maybe you start with a Leyline Seal, Arthas moves in, gets the Howling Blast, then you start with your own ult, so as a little bit more on point damage that can really confirm a kill.
That's a good
that
point.
Might be something that we've been thinking about here too. But this is a solid setup for both sides right now.
Yeah, really good point. Falsett in particular here doesn't really handle Sulfurous Smash that well, hitting him in the face. He kind of melts. There won't even be time for an Ancestral Healing to come out, so that's actually a really good point. So looking over to the drafts a little bit in terms of actual control around the shrines, Team Liquid has the favor here, but in terms of map control, global pressure, of course, it's over to the playing Ducks. Let's see how the Ducks face up against Team Liquid here in game number three. We are tied 1-1.
We have a pretty intense series on our hands. Absolutely fantastic play from both sides here. And once again, we are moving into the next map. It is this time Inferno Shrines into the left side. Nanda on the Dehaka for the playing Ducks. Wolfjoe on Rhaegar. Spotbilly, of course, on the Falstaff. Chris on Gul'dan. And Crisplosion on Anub'arak.
And to the right side in the red, Team Liquid will have Splendor on Malfurion, Blumby on Arthas, showing his Arthas once again after game number two on Towers of Doom, Darkmok on Ragnaros, Hasuab's here for the plays with his Medivh, and Nurok on Tychus.
Nurok on the Tychus here. And yeah, the Hasuab's Medivh, that was the Medivh's overall right now. His role and the importance that he has in a lot of compositions is just rising, and the way that people play him is fantastic. It's just improving overall. When Medivh first came out, we saw a couple of very nice approaches, but the really only team that played Medivh for a very long time in the European scene was Team Expert, ADRD. He loved to do that. Now a lot more teams start to play the hero very regularly. You see him on the side of Dignitas. We have now, of course, these two just like fighting over him quite a bit. And the plays that we've seen out of the Medivh players are just pleasure to watch.
Caldor, when he's talked like that, I feel like we're gonna be getting a nerf on Medivh if he's becoming so prominent in EU. Hopefully it doesn't occur, because he's been such a joy to watch. Four members in the bottom as Blumby will lead the charge in the four-man rotation. Ragnaros and Dehaka in the top lane. Things looking very normal for our teams.
Yeah, pretty normal early game here thus far. And also on the side of Falstaff, of course, going straight into the Season Marksman to put a bit more pressure onto these front lines. So that's going to play a role then. Another thing that we have to point out, I mean, Dash on Nurog as the level 1 talent taken, the Colossal Totem for Rhaegar. It's actually an interesting choice, considering that on this map it's usually the Lightning Bond that we see. But the 16 talent is going to synergize very nicely for Rhaegar, so trying to once again get a little more control over the battlefield.
Which is great against Arthas in particular. You just don't want him to get on your backline. Gul'dan having a hard time dealing with that pressure. And Rhaegar himself can't really bite in and move in. Arthas is just so strong if he does get on that backline. So the Playing Ducks will continue rotating back and forth. I'm waiting for the first shrine here. That's where we're going to get a glimpse at what the Playing Ducks want to do. Do they want to try and squeeze out an experience lead with their globals? Or do they want to go for an aggressive flank on the backline and try and get a pickoff with a Medivh floating around?
Yeah, also down to the bottom of the map, talking about that Medivh. Medivh is now trying to pick up that experience as Anub'arak clears the lane. Level 4 should hit for both of the teams pretty soon, but right now it really feels like we're going to get a bit of a head start for Team Liquid when it comes to the top lane. And yeah, nobody's really moving in for that. We have Gul'dan and Rhaegar poking around a bit, but besides that, we still see two heroes down to the bottom of the map for the Ducks, trying to get some pressure onto the wall.
So the answer is here. The Playing Ducks are working on getting experience, but Team Liquid have responded well. They have Ragnaros in the bottom alongside Hasuab, so they can clear out that wave. They also had Malfurion in the middle to get some experience, and they just leave Arthas and Tychus in the top. So overall, Team Liquid coming out ahead here. Now they stay on even footing in experience, and they should be getting the first Punisher of the game. Hasuab is looking for a kill. Gonna be having a portal soon. Will he go in for it? Crisplosion.
Yeah, you can run. Can you get away there? I doubt it. Oh!
Top lane, though. The Nubrek falls, but everyone else in the Playing Ducks makes a big rotation, and they take out Arthas.
So we have a 1-for-1 in trades, but that also leaves Team Liquid without a real front line. Dehaka can still make his moves there. 36 of those minions, on the other hand, have already been taken by Team Liquid, so the chances of the Playing Ducks to win the objective are slim to none. Even with just a grenade on Norok's side, he will easily be able to catch the last one. So yeah, Liquid doing well in the early game here, but kill-wise, both of them just trading blows.
Blows have been traded here, 39-7, Team Liquid waiting out on grabbing this Punisher, attempting to soak all the lanes, and of course they want to pull members of Playing Ducks back to the other lanes so they can get the Punisher and get into a number advantage if they want to go for an aggressive play with the portal. Remember, with the portal being dropped, you can make the Punisher jump into your opponents because you do give that vision to it. So watch for Team Liquid to potentially make a play here if not all the members are floating around for the Playing Ducks.
Yeah, and the Ducks actually going for the Shrine, just forcing Team Liquid to take the last minion and to really just go for it. And now, once again, baited over. Well done here. The wall on the other side has been opened, and they're trying to see if they can maybe get a kill here. So once again, just in case that you guys are a little bit newer to Heroes, the one thing you have to do if your opponent is getting a Punisher is to move behind the gate. He has an ability that allows him to jump once that he has vision, and he will do that. If that jump happens before you guys cross the wall, then he will find himself in front of the wall, and usually the opponent's team gets a lot of structure damage in. But if you stay behind the gate, and you just poke him a little bit from behind the gate, once he approaches, he's going to jump over. That means an extra tower, and the fort is going to attack him. And then you can take him down a lot easier. You're going to lose less. And if you run with a Punisher, normally what you're trying to do is open the wall like Team Liquid just did at the side, because sometimes you get an opportunity to still kill a target while the Punisher is raging between towers and fort.
Yeah, the two important things that you said there was, one, you got to make sure that you do poke the Punisher if you're on the defending team, because you want to give it vision, because that's how you get it to jump over.
Yeah.
If you give it vision, it comes towards you. And then on the other side for Team Liquid, the aggressor, you want to be able to have some kind of engage. So if the Punisher does jump in and there is an escape, like we saw there on a Nubrak or a Tail Freeze instance, you can go in for the hard engage. A Kerrigan is wonderful for following up on a Punisher.
Yeah, normally when we're looking at the later game, we're probably going to see that again. If a team goes in with a Punisher and it's like maybe even a fort on lane, you will see them open up the wall, and once the Punisher starts to jump in, they will try to lock the target down with, for example, a Howling Blast on the side of Arthas. It's one of the reasons why a Nubrak was the one to bait the Punisher, because once that he started to give the Punisher a vision, he immediately burrowed away. Ancient's double during this, and so the Punisher doesn't lock him down. So even if Team Liquid tries to follow up, he's so far out of range that he can't really do that. So that's a really interesting dynamic there, and you also have to think about who actually baits him over. But the most important part, if you're a little bit newer, once your opponent has the Punisher, move behind the gate. Don't try to be a hero, don't try to poke there at the front, stay behind the gate, wait until the Punisher comes in, and then we're talking.
But Kaldor, this game is Heroes of the Storm. I want to be a hero. I want to make plays.
I'm going to throw my coffee cup in.
9.25 for our teams. Let's look back into the matchup, Heroes. We're getting close to level 10, which means things are about to heat up for our teams. Darkmok is floating in the middle, which means he does have the ability to use Molten Core if needed to help clear out this shrine. Arthas already starts up here on the left.
Yeah, once again, they're trying to move in, but good pressions on the shrine. Team Liquid looking for level 10 as well. That's why they're currently trying to just move into the lane and get more experience. But look at the top, look at the bottom. The two globals are soaking for the ducks, trying to give them the talent advantage to then move in and claim the shrine. But Liquid hits their level 10 first, and they have the lead in the minion count.
And this is where you give a call out to Team Liquid. Against the globals that have been focused on globally soaking the battleground, Team Liquid is still tied with them going into 10. That is a solid job in terms of map control. Sport Billy flying in here. He goes for the Medivh. Leyline Seal instantly out. Blumby on the right side. Mighty Gust being popped. Nurok applying damage. And the Playing Ducks have used everything except Horrify and Ancestor Healing. Blumby moving in.
Yeah, moving in right now, Ziz. They're pushing it in with that Odin, trying to go for it. But this, you can really tell, this is the comfort zone of Team Liquid. This is so much more down their alley right now than what we've seen on the first two maps. And both of our two early maps were the map picks of the Playing Ducks. They had stuff prepared over there. Team Liquid this time, they are feeling way better with this. And look at it. Once again, Punisher baited in. And what did we see? An immediate portal on the side of Team Liquid to see if they cannot capitalize on the Punisher's aggression.
They move forward. They get behind the fort here, which allows for them to focus it down and also potentially use Molten Core. This is making the Playing Ducks play much more passively. Chris Blosion does bait the Punisher over to the keep wall, and it will get cleaned up, but Team Liquid walks away with a fort kill in a very confident manner.
Very well done by them. So the Playing Ducks are all of a sudden in a game where they more or less have to play their opponent's style. And that is something that they seem to be a little bit less confident in than what they've shown on map number 1 and 2, where they were always just dictating the pace of the game. They were the ones really driving the fights, and that's something they can't really do to the same extent just now. So Team Liquid finding themselves in a bit more of a comfortable position, but this game is of course by no means over just yet. It's only one level lead for Team Liquid. They were able to take the fort down, but again, the Ducks are looking for a kill.
Small portal here, Darkmok will be able to get out, and no kill coming their way. Chris Blusion does have Splinter Lock down the right side. The Hawk is coming in with a big burrow. Can he hit the Tongue? The Tongue does connect. There's a Force of Will, and Blumby's on the flank.
Yeah, Malfurion, Splendor got horrified there, trying to move out. Once again, hits his ult as well. Good silence. Splendor still on the run, but finally taken out. Chris, on the other hand, is extremely low, and he ends up falling too. This is a 1-for-1, but not for long, as once again, we are having Molten Core being used, trying to chase down a Nubarak, and that is the death of the bug.
Playing Ducks go a bit too far to get Splinter, but at that point, you're committed, and they got the Malfurion kill, but Team Liquid answers back with two kills of their own. Goldan and Anubarak have fallen victim, almost Falstead too. Sport Billy was able to retreat.
One of the things that actually worked against the Ducks is that Sport Billy had to burn his Mighty Gust cooldown before the fight even started for real, because he got rooted by Arthas and saw that there's a possible engage against him, and he gusted, and just 2 seconds after that, that's when the Ducks started to move in. If he is able to hold that cooldown, if that root doesn't hit him, they have either an easy engage when they are trying to move back after the kill, or they can even try to make a bit of a play with a good positioning before the gust happens. So in this case, still a good trade for like a trade on each side, but that could have backfired a little bit.
Sport Billy going in for aggressive play here.
There we go.
He's gonna hit the huge mighty gust. Dark Monk is gonna be defended here by the Impaler is actually taking the damage from the fort, but he is still locked down. Splinter is hoping to keep him alive. Hasselops is gonna drop the ley line seal. Dark Monk does not get out at the last second. Warify had to be used. Playing Duck burning multiple heroics, but they get a takedown.
I really like also how Team Liquid was trying to save Ragnaros here. Hasops even with the early portal to make sure that he can close the distance to Ragnaros so he can drop the quick shield on it. But in the end, we see Ragnaros falling, and that's of course at a very unfortunate time for them, because now the Ducks with 13 to 13 talents are making a big play for the Punisher, diving in deep for a possible kill against Blumby, but the shield of Medivh is out. Problem is though, Tychus is already dead.
Splinter with the instant silence to keep Nande from paying the drag, but he walks forward and gets the drag on Blumby. Three people have fallen in the last 30 seconds for Team Liquid. Ragnaros just spawns now and he rotates in, but a 23-7 lead on the Shrine should be enough for the Playing Ducks to get the first Punisher of the game.
Ducks are playing really well in these team fights. I'm liking it. We said before the last two fights happened, that they're a little bit more in the comfort zone of Team Liquid in this game, but they are doing very well in the team fights. That was a great engagement for them. The kill against especially Ragnaros was important. We saw also great body blocking on the side of the Haka to make that kill happen. And once again, as they're jumping in here, they are able to force Team Liquid back. It's impressive. It's really impressive what they're doing here today.
Punisher is full health ahead and bottom. You see all Playing Ducks retreating to the middle lane. You might ask why. It's because Molten Core is available for Ragnaros on the right. So they rather head the middle lane. So they get the experience here and move towards 15 and 16, which gives them an experience advantage. Falstad is also in the top lane. So they are subbing two lanes while Team Liquid is forced to deal with the Punisher.
Yeah, and Team Liquid with the defense now are down to the bottom of the map. That's where Ragnaros is currently positioned. But in the mid lane, the four-man defense is strong. Portals everywhere once more. Ragnaros dealing with the situation down there. But the experience lead has changed. It's not any longer Team Liquid who has the lead here. The Globals are still playing a big role in this, of course. The Ducks with a one level lead, and that is going to translate into an early level 16. Now, Team Liquid should still have enough time to get their own level 16 talent before the next Punisher or the next Shrine is happening on the map. So we should see an even fight there, but let's see how this is going to unfold.
Next big fight is going to be important for both of our teams. Because Keeps are in trouble, one in the bottom right and one in the middle here for Playing Ducks. We're gonna have our Mercenaries grab, and it's gonna help out in the experience gain that you were just talking about, as Team Liquid should be soaking both the bottom and the middle lane. They are missing some experience in the top lane as Medivh will head over to make sure to grab that. 15 and a half, they are getting close and they are playing safe.
And of course, with the Playing Ducks, smart as they are starting to push the envelope up to the top lane because they realize, hey boys, we are not only do have a camp pushing in, we also have a talent lead. So see if we can not maybe kill a few of the structures. And I love how Team Liquid is immediately reacting to it. They are trying to protect their well here, most of all. The fort, of course, too. But the well, if they can still have that in play for the next shrine, potentially starting at the top, that would be a big, big advantage to them.
And they do give experience on the bottom, but they're okay with that. They know they can get 16 before the shrine phase, so losing a lane of experience in the bottom, not the worst thing ever, with that well being a possibility for them to save that, to have that tap, to have that defender's advantage. 16 about to hit, and in about 10 to 15 seconds, the shrine should start activating.
Yeah, so Liquid is playing this very cautious and smart, but now they're trying to set something up. Shrine's gonna be in the middle, they go for the Beetle, and Crisplosion is dead. 50 seconds down, Shrine activating in 20. That timing could not have been any better.
Nande came in with the Brush Stalker and he's gonna be forced to immediately burrow away. The Playing Ducks will now be missing out on their tank here, Anubarak, for the next 30 seconds with the Shrine activating in the middle. This would be a wonderful Punisher for Team Liquid to grab.
Yeah, this kill means that Playing Ducks have to give up the Shrine. If they want to make a play for it, that would be a huge risk that they run, and it could mean staggered deaths, and they will try to avoid that at all costs. So instead, they go to the only other 2 points that they have on the map, and that's 2 camps at the bottom that they are currently trying to take here. They still have a lead in experience that should slowly close as Team Liquid will do damage with the Punisher itself. Hazorbs is scouting out the situation. He, of course, has already a bit of an inkling where exactly they could be. I mean, it's the only thing that they could really do. But Liquid will grab the Punisher, and let's see how much damage they can do with it. Like, that kill was fantastic. The kill against the Nuburak, and it was so well timed out. You could really tell once they were about to hit 16, they were already looking for an opportunity to get that early snipe.
Team Liquid not allowing the Playing Ducks to get an advantage on map control. They're going to go to the other shrine to try and push him in. But Falstad makes a big play on a Dark Mach. He instantly will attempt to retreat from the area. Wolf Joe has started to grab the shrine here. Now, all we need is Team Liquid to finish off one more, and they will be awarded the Punisher. They're just trying to get the bottom lane pushed out, so they have to deal with that mercenary camp and can focus all their efforts on going for an aggressive play middle.
Exactly. So Team Liquid is currently deliberately waiting before they grab the Punisher. They allow the opponent to take a position there and grab a few as well. But this gives them time to deal with the bot lane, deal with the rest of the lanes, push them out a little bit, and they know all they have to do is throw a grenade over the wall with Nurog or hitting a Howling Blast, and they will get the Punisher. The reason why the Ducks are moving into the area at all is because they want to force Team Liquid's hand. You don't want to give them too much time. They're basically saying, if you don't hurry, then at some point we are going to grab the Punisher instead. But Liquid isn't taking any risks here. They grab it, they pushed out the bot lane in the meantime, and now with the Molten Core and with the Punisher, we will see them engage. And here's the portal, once again, waiting for that jump over the wall to see if they can maybe get a kill. But no, it's again an Nuburak who baits it back.
Anandis in the bottom lane this entire time. He's soaking that level 19. The Punisher's been brought over to the top left side. This is a really good pull. Gets a couple turrets mixed up onto the Punisher, and also allows for a dive to possibly take him up to the keep on the left side. And good job here, Crisplosion. Continue to bait it to be ineffective.
Nice.
We do have a big burrow in, though.
The drag dodged at this point, and we have Team Liquid moving back early. They know that the Haka would move in. They're still trying to see if they can maybe get some extra damage onto the keep, but they are totally willing to move back here. And it's so important that in such a situation, you keep a cool and clear head, and you're just sitting there and you're saying, like, okay, boys, we've done damage. Can we really take that keep? What is it going to cost us if we take the keep now? What can happen? And the things that could happen, the Haka comes in from behind and forces the fight on you don't want to fight. Falstad flies over you, gusts you in. So they're just simply saying, boys, let's stay cool. We have a good position right now. Move back. And it was the right decision to make. The Haka coming in, missing the dragon. Team Liquid is able to walk away, doing a lot of damage, catching up in experience, and putting themselves in a decent spot for the next fight.
Just add on top of that, even if they didn't have a Dehaka, the Falstad Mighty Gust flying in from behind, the Horrify with the Gul'dan, so many tools for the Playing Ducks to have a stellar defense. Team Liquid just respects it completely. And what they aim to do is grab turrets, get a little bit of damage on the keep, and just mitigate the experience lead that the Playing Ducks had. And they did gain about half a level of experience there.
Especially the Horrify, of course, being an absolutely important point there. I'm happy that you actually raised that. Now, once again, invade by Team Liquid this time, trying to grab the camp here. Both of the teams are just dancing around each other. It's totally beautiful to see how they're looking for any kind of opening they can use.
They're all pushing on the fort here. This experience, again, wonderful for Team Liquid to grab. Anything that can close that gap, this will give them a nice chunk of change. Falstad went to the middle lane, has gotten 20. Now, the moment 20 hits, you're going to see Playing Ducks just ramp up their aggression. They're going to want to get into a kill before Team Liquid hits the 20 of their own. This is where we see TL become the defenders. They sit back, they float around, and they have 2 forts, one in the middle and one at the top, that they can retreat to.
Okay, they have 30 seconds now. 30 seconds to grab that talent, and that's not going to be too easy. I love it. It's really cool to see this right now. So this time, the Playing Ducks are going to have the better position up at the top lane. And we could see Liquid actually pushing even for structures down at the bottom right now, but they're going for the camps instead. So they're trying to put pressure into the mid and the bot lane, and they accept that they will be a bit late to the party up at the top, but it helps them to pick up the level 20, and it also puts the pressure onto the fort, and more importantly, onto the keep in the middle. So the longer the fight at the top lasts, the better for Liquid.
Team Liquid going to be fashion late to this party, but they're going to have level 20, which puts them in a great spot. 7-0 is going to be the lead here for the Playing Ducks. Continues to climb up to 10, but Hasuabs with the scout on the bird immediately jumps in the lane. Dark Mach charges forward. Team Liquid is ready to fight.
It's party time, and we are on the shrine once again. Crisplosion looking for a setup here. We have up at the front Blumby on his Arthas, not popping ults just yet. 10-14 on the minion count. Blumby zoning. Dark Mach with the damage. Nanda moving in. Here comes the Odin on Tychus.
Nurok bringing up the damage, focusing down support. Billy, Nani's in the top left, left corner. His Dark Swarm is down for the moment, so he's not going to go in for an engage. And Team Liquid takes over full control of this top lane. And remember that camp you mentioned earlier? In the middle, it's already hitting the keep.
It's one of the reasons why they're moving back. They are already in a position where they say, guys, if we fight here, first of all, we don't want to push into the Odin. It was a great timing on Nurok's side. It secured the shrine for them. And basically, the Ducks were just looking at the Odin. We're looking at the setup. They're like, pushing into this is going to be rough. And at the same time, we're getting damaged in the mid lane. Let's move back and accept that we're not going to win this one. The risk is too high. So they defend the keep in the middle, but now they have to defend the top lane.
Team Liquid is going for the kill here. Big dive in. Horrify's been popped. Nurok dodges it, does back out. Turns out for the auto attacks, focusing down Chris Explosion. Nurok getting low. He's being focused by Sport. Billy, can the team save him? No, but massive Leyline Seal connects.
Oh, and they whiff the ult on Darkmoke. That's a huge problem. He's trying to get away here, but now the Ducks are gaining momentum and moving in. A great portal by Hazop saves Ragnaros. That was a bit unfortunate. Darkmoke not hitting his ult, and also a bit of, I think, miscommunication. The Leyline Seal came in late from Hazop, so they could not save Tychus, but the Punisher still doing damage on the keep. It looks, though, at least for now, as if the Playing Ducks are once again going to be able to save their keeps. Great defense by them.
That's two keeps the Playing Ducks have saved this game. 21 to 20, they are ahead here in terms of levels. Now, of course, levels in the late game doesn't really matter at all. But still, just a point here, the Playing Ducks continue to soak out those lanes and keep them pushing. That's where that level advantage comes from. Now, with 15 seconds before Nurok pops up, they're going to grab an advantage they can. Maybe poke down this fort slightly. You don't have to force it here, but still, taking the advantage where you can is one of the best things you can do.
I am loving the series, by the way. We have seen fantastic combos by both teams. We have seen incredible setups, and it's just such smart play on both sides in this one as well. Dancing around each other, always willing to yield ground if need to. No one is over aggressive in these situations. They know what's on the line. They know how important these situations are. And the Ducks moving away from the top, for example, that was just so impressive. Them saying, hey, we know it's the late game, but we can still defend here, and if we go in and we lose the fight, which is likely with the setup that our opponent has, we will lose the game. So let's just play this safe, and they're even able to save the keep. Liquid wasn't even able to kill that. Such a great play by the Ducks, getting a kill here now too. And once again, we're reset and waiting for the next shrine. It's a beautiful game. It's really, there's a lot to learn from this.
There is a lot to learn from it. And I just want to point out again, the keeps being saved is incredibly important for the Playing Ducks, even though they have globals. Some teams be, okay, we can give up this keep, we can have one of our globals defend that catapult consistently, but them saving it allows for Nande to be in different lanes that Team Liquid is not even nearby. And he's been putting soft pressure this entire game, that the confidence that the Playing Ducks has in his Dahaka play has been stellar. Now, the big moment is coming soon. One more shrine, and that's where we're gonna have our conclusion here. This is getting to the point where one Punisher can win the game.
Yeah, but look at this. The Punisher is spawning in the middle. And we still have a fort in the mid lane for Team Liquid, but no wells. They can't really go for this. Interesting to note, by the way, we have on the Team Liquid side 4 kills, and every single one of these kills was made by Ragnaros. Every single one of them. So he is really the one to bring in the final blow and take these targets down. The Playing Ducks here with 6 kills so far on their side, spread evenly more or less around the across the entire team. But this is the fight that we've been waiting for. And the Haka is still at the bottom. He's going to wait for that burrow. And Team Liquid is pushing in once again onto the shrine, trying to win it. They have a great setup for this late game here. Lumbi, such a threat at that front line with his Arthas, is moving in once more. Can Team Liquid win another Punisher?
This is a scary moment because Dahaka can burrow in at any point. There are a couple of places for him to jump into. Chris Explosion goes to the engage. Nande on the right side. He does miss the drag. The Horrify is going to hit Lumbi. He's being focused down.
Leyline Seal in the back was also successful. Once again, they're starting to move in. This is good for Team Liquid. All so many cooldowns have been burned by the Playing Ducks. We're seeing Team Liquid moving onto the shrine once more. 22 to 18 minions as we once again have a good route on the ground. There's Darkmoke trying to do as much as he can. The Gust, on the other hand, by Sport Billy into the corner. Also, the old fuels on go. Oh, cooldown, and they're going in. They're trying to get the killer Falstad.
Twilight Dream does hit. Hits multiple members. A fierce match comes out. Does hit Nande. He's still alive. This fight is consistently back and forth. We're having stressful healing from our supports. 36 to 28. The Playing Ducks are 4 away from doing it. Can they get the Punisher?
Such a great serve again by the Ducks team. Liquid had such a good spot, but the Ducks are going deep, trying to get a kill here. They get the Punisher and start to move in. Team Liquid, it was looking so good for them. But then with a great Gust once more, and Gul'dan following up when Fawcett gusted everybody in one area. Gul'dan was immediately there with the damage, and everybody got extremely low. Ults were already burned at the time, so now it's the Ducks pushing into the mid lane. But only a few more seconds until Arthur's gonna have his own ult back. The same is true for Medivh. Already Darkmoor going straight for the Molten Core and helping out with the defense.
Poking down the Punisher, and this is the high-level Heroes of the Storm that we come to watch every day in the HEC. Crisplosion diving in for the Burrowcharge. Blumby sidesteps it. Nurok focusing him down. Mighty Gust. Playing Ducks are playing for keeps.
They are going for the keep, and they are taking this. That Punisher is a high, is a really late-game Punisher. A lot of scaling happening here. 24 minutes into it, Punisher not going for core yet, and the Playing Ducks are looking for an opportunity to get a kill. Good cleanse on Tychus. Dragnaut coming into play. Here comes the Horrify, the Ley Line countering it immediately. Splendor in trouble.
Sulfurous Smash connects. Splendor alive. He bolts away. Oh, everything is being put on the table here. Nurok focusing Chris. Chris falls. Crisplosion turning around. Will Burrow charge away? And the Punisher eventually does get killed off on the right side. Nande burrows away, and the Playing Ducks lose one member. Can they escape here from Medivh?
Team Liquid is moving in. Points on the core already lost on their part as the Punisher was hammering away at it. But this one kill, those 40 seconds, that's the window of opportunity for Team Liquid. They're moving through that mid lane. How much can they do here? The kill on their keep is inevitable. Can they do more?
They're pushing in. Lumby here will tank the keep. It gets focused. Everyone from the Playing Ducks are posturing, tapping up their mana, getting health, and the Team Liquid goes for the defensive play. They grab one keep. So now we have catapults. The lanes are even in the middle. This game is going to late game. Can they get another keep? Crisplosion says no.
Crisplosion is moving away. Oh my god, they actually save the keep top. So again, again it's reset. Both of them have lost the keep in the mid lane. The lanes are even at this point, and we are waiting once more for the next shrine. And guys, the next shrine, we are talking 26 minutes at this point already. That Punisher is going to be a monster.
And Team Liquid had a perfect defense there in the middle. They baited over the Punisher. They got it on the keep. Blumby sidestepping Crisplosion went in for the engage. They then baited the Punisher over. Splendor got focused down. He bolted away.
And Splendor got focused by the Punisher after that.
Yes.
And he's just like, get off me.
Just please stop hitting the support.
trying to run away there. It was so good. And he actually escapes. But what a beautiful game. 6 kills against 5. So much happening here. Fought at the bot lane now also falling. Both of the teams on level 23. And it is showtime. Top lane. It is the death trap. It's the one shrine where there is no escape to the top. Once you are in that circle, you are in trouble. And oh boy, I cannot wait to see what happens here.
And the Playing Ducks, realizing how important this shrine is, get there first. Team Liquid can afford not to be the first because of Medivh. Having that Raven form gives you the vision, gives you the portals in that you would like to have. So they take the time to push the bottom lane and the middle lane and get mercenaries putting pressure on the Playing Ducks. So now Playing Ducks are forced to win a team fight or to win the shrine quickly.
This is so intense. This is so intense right now. There we have it. Again, the push up at the front. Arthas is there. Blumby takes the position. No ults used just yet. And we have Chris Explosion moving into the back line, looking for an opportunity to go for Norok. Immediately the Howling Blast, but he escapes it.
Nande still in the bottom lane. Can brush tuck in at any point. Splendor playing careful, assisting his teammate. Blumby in the front is going to pop the Army of the Dead. The portal's been dropped. One for Vision and two for an escape for Blumby. We have all five members up here. 5-on-5.
The dodge on the ice block at that moment. I have to change my pants after this game. This is insane. Once again with the portals, they're escaping. Leyline Seal on the ground. Liquid is trying to go for it. Everybody stopped at this point. Here comes the Horrify though, and that's a problem.
Darkmoth did use the first match trying to get support. Billy and the first member to fall is going to be Nurok. And Tychus is down as well. And the Playing Ducks can focus down the Punisher. This could be game.
Chris with a play. The Horrify. That was the Horrify 2 the win right there. He gets Tychus, he gets Arthas, and they are able to take Tychus down. That's the beginning of the end. Arthas also trying to move away here, and that doesn't happen. That's 40 seconds down now, and of course the Ducks are going straight for the Punisher. They grab it, and they really walk through that top lane and try to go for the core. Playing Ducks with a decisive lead at this point in the game, trying to make it a 2-1 lead in the best of five series.
Playing Ducks getting fierce. All members in the top pushing in. Hasselhoff is going to drop down the vision, get an idea of what their opponents are doing. Team Liquid theoretically can defend this if they kite this Punisher well and pull it in, but they have to deal with the Punisher and five members of the Playing Ducks pushing into their key. Molten Core has been used in the top. This allows Darkmon to spend more time shelling away on the Punisher and the back line rather than doing it on the keep in the top right. They forfeit it.
At that damage! That thing is insanely strong right now. That Punisher alone should be able to end it. Can Liquid pull off a miracle defense here? That's the question. They're fighting. There comes the Odin. They're doing whatever they can. Spoilbilly has to use the Mighty Gust as he's being attacked. He's taken down! The Ancestral doesn't hit. Can Team Liquid really defend this?
Splendor going in with a sick Twilight Dream. Blumby's on the back. He's just buying time. Everyone else from Team Liquid is focused on the Punisher. They are clearing it out. Blumby lives in Hasselhoff, drops down the Leyline Seal. Blumby can come back home. He is safe. Now the Punisher is starting to hit the core. Four members here for the Playing Ducks. They're going to retreat. They're going to survive.
Are you kidding me? They actually defend this. You got to be joking. They defend against a 29-minute Punisher, are able to get a kill. The bot lane is being pressured against Liquid. This is crazy, Trick.
This is why Team Liquid is considered one of the best in the HTC. Not considered, actually showing in stats, 8-0. They are in the HTC Europe, and it's because of how controlled they are in the fights. So let's take a quick look here. In the middle, the Molten Core is being used. It's shelling away on the back line. They're just trying to get damage in. The big Q from Darkmok really helped out in this fight. He comes around on the bottom left, swings in, hits Falstad, Nande, and Crisplosion. Nerop moves forward. Here goes the Force of Will. The Horrify does pop out, but Splendor blinking in for the Twilight Dream helps secure the kill there on Falstad.
The fact alone that Ragnaros didn't die there is just blowing my mind. Not only didn't not die, but they were also able to just simply get that kill then against Falstad. Amazing defense, baiting the Punisher into the middle, the entire team, left, right, buying time for the core to also do work. We are 31 minutes into this game, 31 minutes in Heroes of the Storm. This is awesome.
The Playing Ducks, while they didn't end the game there, they did get one more additional keep. Mid lane and top lane will be in constant pressure consistently from those catapults. Team Liquid needs to get the map flowing for them and then move on to a shrine. Now, they can do it well because they have a Medivh, but it's still a hard, hard task to pull off.
Team Liquid has not lost a series this entire season. The Playing Ducks, on the other hand, so far in the middle of the standings, and they are playing the game of their life at this point. They are putting Team Liquid on the brink of defeat on the third map, and for some reason, Liquid is still alive in this. This is crazy. How did that Ragnaros survive?
The control, the aid there from both Splendor and Hasselhoff was on point. The Force of Will being there, the heals, the immediate turnaround too. He had a massive cleave on three members that gave him that healing. That's so important for Ragnaros. And as we start to gear up for this late game, I don't know how they're going to do it again.
All right, so at this point, I mean, to be absolutely honest, when Chris hit that one Horrify at the fight that we saw to the top, I thought, okay, this is it.
Yeah.
This is it. Two heroes down, and you have a Punisher 29 minutes in, this is game. Punisher alone is going to wreck this, and Team Liquid pulls off the defense. We are resetting this once more for another fight over the shrine and for another Punisher. I don't think I've ever seen a past 30-minute Punisher on this map.
Yeah, it's going to be terrifying. If they can get it to the actual core, the Punisher by itself should be able to kill off the core. There are things to really recognize here, though, for the Playing Ducks, is they, again, have double global. We're getting to a point where it's almost Dragonshire-esque level of double global. It's so hard to deal with. You're going to be able to have pressure in the middle and the bottom lane. It might be okay for the Playing Ducks just to push out all the lanes and then come in for a last-second rotation and just get catapult pressure on the core.
It's a really good point. Like, that's another thing. Catapult pressure, if you can make that happen, that would be fantastic. The thing is, though, both of the teams have lost the keeps at the top and in the middle. Mm. So both of those are gone. I think they saved the one.
Yeah, the keep is still good for Playing Ducks.
Yeah, completely right. So they still have it in place. yeah, that could be a problem for them. This late in the game, we're talking Winions here.
Yeah, Winions. 2 to 3 catapults on the core, and you give them 15 to 20 seconds, that's a dead core.
Yeah, not only that, just think about it for a moment. If you are at the defense, and then you are able to push that wave in, all of a sudden you're saying, like, guys, we don't actually have to defend right now. Let's just, like, go over there with the Daihaka, fly in with a false stat, push with the catapults, and just, like, try and backdoor that. You could actually make that play. The one problem with this is, of course, you have with Vision still that Medivh hanging there. So you will only be able to get the two globals into play. The rest of the team will not be able to make that rotation without Hazelob picking up on it.
Yeah, the Hazelob is going to be very important here for multiple reasons. One, because he needs to scout out what we just talked about. And then two, he needs to be with the team as a five unit. This team as five just naturally has to be together to clear out those waves. So they're going to try and get the rotations done. We're going in, we're going to see the finale of this game as we are getting very close to it ending. Remember, this is the third game. We are tied 1-1. We get more games after this. Let's see how it ends out here for the Playing Ducks and Team Liquid. Here we go. Catapults pushing. The shrine is activating. It is in the very far south, which is stressful for Team Liquid.
It is not only stressful for Team Liquid. I mean, I'm already having, like, I have adrenaline pumping. I'm not even playing there. I'm excited. So we are going for the shrine activating in 10 more. Splendor and his boys are setting up position here. The Ducks are on the move as well, trying to find some kind of angle that they can exploit here. And Hazelob's, of course, doing what he has to do. He is going for the Vision. They know there is a potential threat of being backdoored.
And Playing Ducks realizing where they're at, they send Nande to the top left. He's going to start dealing the pressure on the top lane. There is one catapult, two catapults. Those two catapults do get over to the core. They can start applying damage. Team Liquid has begun the shrine. They know they have to get this going. The quicker they get close to finishing the shrine, the quicker the Playing Ducks have to come respawn.
Yeah, still up at the top lane. Nadehaka, is he going for another wave? It looks like he will. Same time though, they are going for, yeah, they go Molten Core. They're saying, boys, we have to rush this. They know what's happening at the top lane. They know they cannot waste time here. So they're trying to use the Molten Core to get as much damage in as they possibly can. And they get a lot, 32 already. Two catapults moving in. Falstad is there as well. Medivh is already moving back. He sees what's happening here. Another catapult also in the middle. They need to deal with this. But the Punisher is very likely going over to Team Liquid. They are pushing everyone back.
Gust.
That's the Gust also used. Hazelob's on the way to the left. They need to be careful. Here comes an Uberog with a quick engage. They need to go in. And here comes the portal, the ley line. Where is it?
The Force of Will comes out. The ley line on the back left. Sulfurous Smash going in. The Ancestor Healing going to be hitting on top of Chris. He will live. Blumby is low. Force of Will popping out. Splendor bolts in to help out with the heal. The ley line seal connects with four people. Catapults are on the core, though.
Catapults!
Is going back to defend. Everyone else from Team Liquid is trying to make the plays to live. It's just
no
dropping.
Way.
The core
the
is
minions.
In focus.
The Winions!
The Winions!
It's over!
They win! No!
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 5%! It's 5% on the core! Nande is still fighting! Falstad is flying in! Falstad is going for it! And
Sport
he takes
Billy.
The core down! Sport Billy again with the play! And GG as the Ducks take the lead!
The Playing Ducks do it in the most ridiculous manner I think I've ever seen in a Heroes of the Storm game. Sport Billy with the clutch engage there at the back right. Solid play overall. And I am at a loss for words.
That was so good. That was such a great game, and the ending there as well. Smart decision making, going in with the Dehaka at the top, the Falsa in the middle, flying back, going into the fight, putting the pressure on Arthas, who nearly falls, gets saved. Awesome.
What I want to know is if Dark Monk actually knew that he had enough to save the core with the clear that he had. He just went in solo by himself, dealt with 6 catapults, I believe, with 5%. Was that calculated? Because the other four members
no
went
way.
In for a
no,
hard
no, no,
engage.
No, absolutely no way that he knew that he had enough to save it. I don't think they expected the catapults to be this strong.
Yeah.
Yes, we're always talking about Winions, about how the catapults also scale into the late game, but you expect that they chunk the hit points away quite a bit slower. It's very rare that these players are playing a game that lasts 30 minutes plus.
Sure.
That doesn't happen a whole lot in competitive play. So they knew it would hurt. I don't think they expected it to hurt that much.
It's incredible how small advantages that Playing Ducks just etched out over time eventually came to this moment in the late game that
yeah.
just secured them the victory. Great play by them. They never overchewed, but neither did Misfits. It really came, or Team Liquid, it really came down to the globals being available in that last second clinch play.
That was such a fantastic game.
Yeah.
33 minutes and 28 seconds on the clock at the end of this one. And again, best of 5, and the Ducks are in the lead.
The Ducks are in the lead 2-1. They have a possibility here. They have a chance to secure a win in our next match, take it 3-1, and they put Misfits on their first loss of the season in a match overall. They would go down to 8-1. That is impressive to say. Let's go ahead and continue to think about this. What are we going to get in game number 4? Because now we've seen multiple different styles from the Playing Ducks.
I actually don't know. My hands are sweaty. I'm shaking a little bit. Like, this is the game where we said it's more the home ground of Team Liquid, just because it wasn't really that, hey, we dive your backline, we take you down, we just push in
more
and
control.
Get a single kill. So this was more of a normal game where you try to control the battleground, you go into the straight up 5v5 fights. It's something that Team Liquid is very comfortable with, but the Playing Ducks were able to match it and win the game in the end. So right now, this is a tricky situation for Team Liquid, no doubt about it. So I don't know. I make no predictions after what we've seen so far.
Well, let's go ahead and take a quick little break, get our teams ready to go, make sure you're ready to go. We'll be right back with game number 4.
Three members dead here. Tiger's Clone is going to be going down. Same with Savage. 5-0 wipe here. Oh, even the Bolt Root! My goodness!
Oh no!
Mary Day is a legend!
Nature is not always kind.
Gotta make sure they don't group up versus that combo, because it will obliterate them.
It may happen again here if they actually try to force this. Look at this, just Tist and Gyocha going to help buy time for the rest of the team to rotate up. They're gonna get the kill on Y. 3v5, mind you. Here's the Void, Doran Cat, and here comes Malphier, and he's coming up here. They're gonna try to steal this. There's a palm that goes down in the sink. They're unable to get the steal, but they were so close. They still get the kill on Jin Zhao top there with a Saphira smash, and this actually very well may be a wipe with Reset's Glory here. And in fact, this camp is not even capped yet. They didn't even get it, and Black is gonna steal it away and get a wipe, starting with a 2v5. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you MVP Black.
Perhaps I'm not the only prodigy here after all.
Bottom left on the left side, SCSC event there. Going to be having a big container threat coming out. Model Life does pop adapt. Hey, shit. Sign on the left side. There is the big Aegis coming out. Syndication pop at the same time. Void Prison being dropped as well here. Sign being focused down. He does jump into the Void Prison with the power slide into the Moffitt. Noblesse will get silenced, but not before Li Ming falls. Tyrael to fall as well.
So much hope here for Soy as well to keep everybody alive. Connect here, Noblesse here for the follow-up slide. Nice dodge here by Modern Life, and he actually gets the burrow off, but it won't matter.